Thank you for coming here today. I would like to thank Finance Latvia Association and Nasdaq Nordic for organizing this debate, and of course Free Trade Union Confederation of Latvia for hosting this event. The population aging is a growing problem for our society, not just here in Latvia, but also in Europe and even in other continents. And because of the rising cost of pension, this phenomenon is also a challenge for our economy and our public finances. The EU demographic challenge can be summed up in one simple statistic. Today, there is one pensioner for every four people of working age. But in 50 years, this ratio will be about 1 to 2. Also here in Latvia, the population of working age is expected to shrink by 20% by 2060. This will all have major effects on our pension systems. Despite important reforms carried out in many EU member states, state-based and occupational pensions will come under increased pressure. Let me give you a figure. Those who are retiring between 2057 will need to collect an extra $2 trillion each year to achieve an adequate retirement income. This is what we know as a pension gap. And the question is where this money will come from. And there are no easy answers. But I believe private personal pensions are at least part of the answer, and here is why. In Europe, we already have one of the highest saving rates in the world. But too much of what we save is lying in low interest bank accounts without being put to active use. By encouraging more voluntary investment into private pension funds, the money could be directed into a more productive investment and also earn a higher return. However, this is not happening today because European markets for personal pensions are still fragmented and uneven. In some parts of the Union, they are even close to non-existent. Only 27% of Europeans in working age are currently investing in personal pension products. And cross-border selling and portability of existing personal pensions is very limited. This makes pension products more expensive because they lack economies of scale. And it leaves retirement savers with fewer options. This is why the Commission adopted our proposal for a pan-European personal pensions product, or PEPP. PEPP is designed to offer citizens a voluntary and additional option to save up for retirement. By opening up a genuine pan-European market for personal pensions, we want to make it more attractive for Europeans to invest their pensions in capital markets. I am pleased that less than 3 weeks ago, the final PEPP text was adopted by European Parliament. Now, the only remaining step before the law can be adopted is the Council's approval, which is expected by June of this year. In the meantime, the Commission will work closely with EIOPA, the European Insurance and Occupational Pension Supervisor, on the implementation of PEPP. To make it an attractive option, PEPP has many built-in benefits, both for savers and for providers. First, it will be simple and cost-effective with a default investment option that caps cost at 1% of the yearly accumulated capital. Second, PEPP will be fully transparent on the costs and fees, and it will always be accompanied by tailored advice. Third, PEPP will be flexible so that savers can benefit from national incentives where these exist. There will be also a possibility for savers to switch providers regularly at capped cost to stimulate competition on the market. Fourth, PEPP will help create a true single market for personal pensions. Thanks to the standardized core features of PEPP and the single license, savers from across the EU will be able to purchase a PEPP online. To some extent, PEPP will also allow savers to keep saving in the same product even when they are moving across the borders in the EU. However, I regret that the final agreement reached by the European Parliament and the Council did not preserve the European Commission's much more ambitious approach on portability. And finally, PEPP will create opportunities for new market entrants, such as asset managers, to compete with more traditional providers, such as insurers. but at the same time, insurers will be able to pool assets and reap economies of scale by moving from mostly domestic to cross-border distribution. This will be especially attractive in those EU countries where the supply of personal pensions products is currently limited. Some providers have already announced that they are preparing to offer a PEPP. This could appear on the market soon after the entry into application of the regulation. With PEPP in place, we estimate that the European market for the personal pensions products could triple in size by 2030. This is roughly from 700 billion euros now to 2.1 trillion euros in 2030. And this is twice the growth rate expected to take place without PEPP. In other words, PEPP could make a significant contribution towards bridging the pensions gap. However, to reap those benefits, we must implement PEPP properly. In particular, the Commission has recommended to member states that they give the same tax treatment to PEPPs as they give to similar existing national personal pensions products. And this even if PEPP does not match all national criteria for tax relief. So let me take this opportunity to urge the member states to implement this recommendation, and the Commission will closely follow the progress made at national level. In conclusion, PEPP will provide a voluntary option for people to save for their pensions alongside their occupational and state-based pensions systems available today. If we get this right, PEPP will be an important step towards single market for personal pensions. It will help to build a capital markets union, and it will help us reach the pensions gap. So, thank you for attention, and I wish you a fruitful discussions today.